I mean, what a fucking weasel. Do I even have to say what a weasel?
I didn't ask for the job.
I'm sure everyone could have guessed, even if you didn't see my tweet. But boy, it took while Steve was saying, I don't think I'll be in Madawaska. Craig's fucking texting away.
I said if he needs help on the transition.
Now, yeah, hold on. I'm all fucking tangled up here.
I didn't say give me the job.
You know, I observe a great man broadcast once a week now. Mm-hmm. And to steal a page from his playbook, walk me through how you would help Steve transition to the next producer.
Well, you see, no,
what would Craig do?
If he has sound that he needs edited or anything that he just doesn't feel like doing.
Wouldn't that be like Justin or Carano or someone that has actually worked there before?
He's just throwing it out there. He's been helpful with me.
So has he? He's responded to you before.
Yeah.
Okay. So you have somewhat of a relationship. Very
small. He's reached out, told me how he runs phones without me asking, by the way, just letting me know. So I was returning the favor.
Okay. That makes me feel a little better. Because I was like, what a fucking... Hey, Steve, you need a ride to the airport when you're leaving? Or
you need to tune up on that van?
Steve, you know, I'm great with RVs, actually. If you need a cameraman to document your journey. I like that, too, that Craig is... I'm still doing a podcast, and Craig is kissing up to the guy who's just caravanning around the world.
Well, dude, it was crazy. That was a crazy episode.
It was wild. No pun intended, did not see that coming at all. You know?
No. And you can tell it's been bugging him for a while, because if you listen to him at the beginning of the episode and the end, he sounds so relieved at the end. It's crazy.
Yeah, he threw out Madawaska too. It was like he wanted, it's funny just because I was talking to him before the show. And it didn't even, you know, we were just talking about the usual horse shit, whatever was in the news. And then, like, first thing right off the bat, you want to talk about Madawaska?
Oh, yeah. He was like, let's get this out of the way.
Yeah. Rip this Band-Aid off. But, no, good for Steve. As I said yesterday on my solo show, which you can go to patreon.com/blindmike if you want to check that out. We have $1 tier available now where people are watching live as we speak. So that could be you folks at home. And there's a hell of a lot more than there are here. So, come on, it's a dollar a month. They used to say it was the price of a cup of coffee. Yeah. It's the price of the shit you dump out in the street when you're done with your coffee.
By the way.
A dollar a month, for Christ's sake.
I got to stop you. It's very, very mean of you to tell everyone to call me a racist homophobe.
I mean, is it not true?
It's very untrue.
Every time I try to get serious for a few moments, this guy is, you know, David Duke made some good points. It's constant.
Do we have to return to the famous honeymoon where I was hanging out with black lesbians?
See, that's what a racist does, too. That's what, right? Oh, I've met one black person.
It was three of them.
Immediately, like your best friends.
We were getting along great.
Yeah. So, yeah, folks, if you're listening, call at CraigVGS. A racist homophobe on Twitter.
I don't do that.
And, no, he's a good man. But it is funny. I got a text right away. Just so you know, I texted Steve.
Well, I was letting you know.
All I could think of is, what does he think would come of that? Because I was a good guy. I mentioned you on the air.
I know. I heard that.
I believe that was met with, you know, I hope he dies in a bus accident. Steve. Which I feel like that's, you know, you got your answer. All right. Enough said.
No, I was letting you know so you didn't find out secondhand and have the story be backwards.
That's what I would be doing too.
Backwards.
I related to that text.
Okay.
I very much related. Just so you know, I do. This is going to be taken out of context.
Throwing it out there just so when this comes back in my face, I want you to know. No,
I understood that completely. Although you are a bit of a weasel, I think you would jump ship. If that was offered to you, which you should do, but just, you know, admit your true colors, for Christ's sake.
Would I have to stop doing this?
No, but would you want to keep doing it?
Yeah. No, I...
A bit of a hesitation. No, I appreciate that.
No, yes, I love doing this. But...
Well, it's because you've never experienced anything better, you know?
Well, the topics...
I want you to get a taste of an actual podcast.
Wait till Tuesday, fellas. Part two, Tom Myers. I love this shit.
Oh, that's right. Yes.
I love doing it.
If you want to find out about Tom Myers, or you know him already and want to laugh along with us, go to the patreon.com/blindmike. Also, annual tiers, I guess you would call them, available. So you get basically, if you sign up annually, you basically get 2 months free, I think is how it works out.
Fuck so, you.
Yes. A little taste of old Tommy Myers, who interacted with us on Twitter, by the way.
Immediately.
Like, yeah, I suspect maybe it doesn't have a lot going on.
I didn't even know the video was posted until I saw that he tweeted about it. Like, it was quick.
A funny, see, that's what I mean though. He's got somewhat of a sense of humor about himself. He's just not very self-aware, I don't think.
No, I still don't think his sentence structure is very good, because somebody went at him and he goes, if by this you mean something that wouldn't fit, I forget exactly what the wording was.
Oh, it's terrible. His comebacks I follow him on Twitter.
It was real poor.
He seems like a nice enough guy, which is why I try to do it in good faith, you know?
Yeah.
yeah, go check that out on Patreon if you'd like. But yeah, good for Steve, as I said. Congratulations. It seems weird to say congratulations, because I think he's leaving two of the best podcasts in the world. So it's odd to be like, hey, attaboy. I think taking your mental health by the balls is it's always a good thing. And I would recommend it for anyone if you can get away with it.
Without him saying it, it seemed like he wants to stay on the case full time and make that his full time job.
I don't want to do too much of that just because I'll do it with them when I'm on the show.
Yeah.
But I didn't get that vibe really, you know, I threw that out there a couple times. Like, would you just do that? And he was like, no.
Oh, I thought he did, because he was talking about maybe next, the season two of it being whatever, and then coming back full time for the third.
Yeah. Well, like I said, I'll talk about it with them. You know, let's go to this. I know Craig's very tight with Steve. They're best buddies.
Yeah, we're
so
best
I might as
buds.
Well just talk to Craig about it. But I can go right to the straight to the horse's mouth.
I thought it wasn't going to go answered at all. But I was just like,
yeah. Now when I want to know how Steve's doing out in Montana, I'll say, hey, Craig, give me a Steve update.
He wrote me a note.
Yes, I will. That's the other thing too, is I will certainly make fun. I want this known. I will certainly make fun of him when pictures of him in front of the world's biggest ball of yarn come out. But I do think it's a good thing. Like, I, you know, to kind of take a break and unplug yourself, I think is a good move. It worked wonders for me. So more power to him.
Yeah.
If that's what he needs to better his mental health, it'll be funny if he winds up on like Louder with Crowder in 3 months.
He pulls up, goes full Landau.
Yeah, right. He's just a traitor. But no, he seemed like I would talk to him for about, you know, 30 seconds after the show, and he did seem like a weight had been lifted. So good for him. And we will get to that. I guess we'll be on all week next week as you're hearing this. So a week from today, if you're listening to this for free.
Oh yeah.
On the Great Kirk Minahan Show. So I want to get to this, you know. Boy, they've given us outdoor privileges and recess time now.
Oh, yeah.
You get to interact with people. So I want to get to that in a minute. I'm very excited.
Makes me want to get my shot.
But if we follow the rules, we can do all that. But I do want to talk about, because the Steve thing made me think of all sorts of mental health shit that I talked about yesterday. And then this week, I kind of realized it was getting to everyone because of Steve's thing. But also, I watched Alba have one of the saddest interactions of all time. But it made me laugh so hysterically that I felt I had to relay it to you people. She had, there's an unfortunate family incident. So some of her family needs to leave the country, which is not that easy right now. So she has to kind of be the liaison for them and make all the calls for like an emergency passport and all that type of shit. So she was trying to do that the other night. And the first time she tried, she gets through at like, it's like 7 o'clock at night or something. So I imagine the B squad is on staff.
Oh yeah.
At whatever government office shithole this is. And she talks to someone, and I'm in the living room just kind of overhearing this. And he's like, yeah, what's your name? And she spells the name and everything. And he goes, all right, we got you. And I was like, that's surprising because she's got a heck of a last name. You know, I don't want to generalize, but she was Muslim. So you can imagine how many consonants are in that fucking thing.
In a row.
Yeah. So it's a difficult name to spell, and they just kind of breezed over it. And he's like, yeah, come on in Wednesday. She's like, all right, that was easy. And then she never got a confirmation email the next day. So she calls him again and goes, hey, I never got a confirmation, so I just want to make sure. And they were like, who did you talk to? And she's like, oh, I don't know, Jerry. And they're like, oh, Jerry cleans up here overnight. So he just answers the phone sometimes. He's fucking nobody.
He had an egg salad sandwich in his other hand.
Oh, you rascal, Jerry. Yeah, my son's making prank calls again. I'm sorry. He shouldn't be answering the phone. So they told her, yeah, no, we have not even close to a record of you existing. She's like, all right, I guess we'll go through this process again. So this time it's a lot longer because they're actually doing their job. And she has to spell that fucking name for him again. And it was so many times, and they're like, you know, S, and she's like, no, F. And they're like, V, and she's like, no, D. It's constant. So then they go to, then it becomes the Brian Regan bit. It's like, L is in Lucas. Y is in yourself. And then she gets to, you know, she gets to T, and she just goes into T as in. And I couldn't see her at the moment. I was in the other room, but I just imagined like, come on, Albert. You got this. You can come up with a T word. I know you can. So that goes on for a while. Now they have the name spelled, but they're repeating it back to her with the same, you know, D as in dog, B as in boy, all that bullshit. But they're getting every letter wrong. And she's like, nope, man. nope, that's not it. And she's like, no. That's why at one point I hear her go, because she's very polite. She's a polite lady. And at one point I hear her go, I don't know what's happening here, but you're misspelling it every time. Oh, and boy. Obviously, like I said, you know, it was a family tragedy. So, you know, emotions are high, not to mention a certain time of the month, which I feel like is every other week, for Christ's sake. But
twice a month.
But there's a lot, you know, my point is emotions are at an all-time high. And then on the maybe 20th spelling of her name, I hear a human emotion that even the likes of Daniel Day-Lewis or Meryl Streep could not capture. It's a very subtly, you know, D as in dog, and then you start to hear her voice break a little. B as in boy. O as in Oscar. S as in safety. And it just gets more emotional as the name goes on. And I was just giggling my ass off in the next room. Yet it was also the saddest thing because I was like, boy, this, you know, a year of a pandemic and being trapped with me, who had an emotional breakdown, which wore on her. And now she's got this family bullshit. It all led to some poor schmuck on the other end of the phone line that could not spell this ungodly name. And it just, the floodgates opened at that point. And then I hear the lady on the other end of the phone like, ma'am, I'm so sorry. We're going to get to the bottom of this.
On a scale of 1 to 10, how bad of a family tragedy are we talking?
Five, right in the middle. Five, I'd say.
Because I'd say like a young death is 10.
Yeah. Well, I'm like an older person.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah. So sad, but you know, come on.
You're just laughing at her.
No, very sad, of course.
It's an aunt, but, so you're like, you got about 58 more of them. Relax.
Buckle up, lady. This is a hell of a last name. We're going to be doing this a lot. So I just thought it was so funny because it was honestly, I think that reaction. Like, I wish I had it on film, because if, you know, if we put a time capsule in the ground for the aliens that have feasted on our flesh to know what humanity was like, when they get to the year 2020 and they're like, what was the pandemic like? I feel like that phone conversation encapsulates it. It started out with such positivity.
She can't just go down.
They just forgot to send my confirmation email. This won't go wrong. And it ended in tears. But the level of I hope I did that justice, because it was a breakdown that you could just see slowly happening.
Everyone's more focused on you laughing at her, from what I'm gathering.
Like, ma'am, I'm sorry. I couldn't hear this one over the maniacal laughter in the background. Is Arthur Fleck with you, madam?
Did she know you were laughing?
Oh, yeah. Because a few times I yelled out suggestions for letters.
That's the visual I need. Toilet paper. T for toilet paper.
It'd be funny if you took all the letters I said and that's actually her last name. Like, I just fucked up and spelled it for you guys.
That's great.
So that has all led to, and I feel like that was kind of the climax of the pandemic, because now we've all been good boys, and they're going to let us get outdoors time, so that's fun.
Like, how that was a big long way around we can do stuff again.
Congratulations. That was the last step.
I can laugh at her from a balcony now.
The government was just like, all right, we need to get one girl to cry and then we'll let him back outside.
Just put a dog with like a pumpkin spice latte, they'll all cry.
They're like, should it be a foreigner? Trump's not in office anymore. They're like, no, just make her do it.
Trump's, dude, speaking of Trump, that Shane Gillis sketch.
It was great.
It was the funniest Donald Trump sketch I've ever seen.
That's weird. It's, you know, like a sketch show should think about hiring that guy.
Yeah, wouldn't that be crazy?
Yeah. Yeah, go check out Shane Gillis' sketch. I mean, it was actually funny. It wasn't... Here's my political takedown of Donald Trump. I'm going to really show him what's what. It's what they should have been doing for 5 years. It's what, honestly, because like, it's not a perfect impression. It's a funny impression. You know what I mean? The same way Dana Carvey was with George H.W. Bush, the same way Will Ferrell was with Bush. It wasn't like, wow, I closed my eyes and thought George Bush was in the room. But it was just a funny, it was close enough, and it was a funny caricature of a guy. And that's what Shane Gillis did in that sketch. And it's like, that's humor. You don't need to send us a message. It made us laugh.
Well, it's just like the Trump caller, where it doesn't necessarily sound like him, but he's got the mannerisms down to a T.
Right, and it sounds enough like him.
Yeah.
You know, where it could fool someone.
And the makeup was just hilarious.
But your pussy stinks.
It stinks and this chair smells. But speaking of Shane Gillis, he no longer is the Asian hate comic.
I was gonna say he's starting a podcast with Tony Hinchcliffe. It's just called, well, never mind, I was gonna say it. It's called Blank in the Armor.
I was just gonna say. I saw a but by the way, people saying that America is racist is crazy. I saw a Saudi Arabian ad for Chinese food. They had a new restaurant, and it was just a guy, a Saudi Arabian guy.
Hinchcliffe's bit.
Yeah. No, it was a Saudi Arabian guy with like the headdress on and everything, just stretching his eyes out with the plate of food in front of him.
Jesus Christ.
And I was like, yeah, we're so bad over here.
Well, I mean, I think that's why it really gets my goat as much as it does, because it's like, I don't know, are we this fucking crazy racist country, or do we just say shit that's on our minds sometimes, or make jokes that are silly and make us laugh? Like, I don't know, is it the end of the fucking world? So if you haven't heard it, which this will come out Monday, so I imagine by now you probably have, but maybe not actually, because this is one that I think if you're not a like inside comedy fan, then maybe you missed it. Because it didn't get that big, did it?
I think today it got at its biggest.
Okay. So yeah, let's play what Tony Hinchcliffe said and then we'll break it down.
Keep in mind, the person who posted this video is the comic introducing Tony Hinchcliffe here.
Yes. And would you care to say his name, Craig? Because I am terrified to.
Peng Deng.
Now, he's not being offensive, folks. That is the man's name. Oh, so just keep that in mind.
All right, yeah, I got it. Yeah, just keep tweeting that out on Twitter. Racist. Yeah,
so Peng Deng.
He's probably gay, too.
He's introducing. Now, let's not clip that part. I don't know anything about the man. So I'll restart this for whatever clip we're going to put out there. Peng Deng, take it away.
Give it up for the one and only Tony Hinchcliffe.
Speeding him walking out.
Hello, good evening, welcome, hello. How about one more time for the filthy little fucking chink that was just up here?
So, listen. I mean, I'm sorry. It's obviously not funny.
It's hilarious. That's why.
No. That's not funny at all, Craig. Please, restart it because I want to take. I was laughing at something else.
Yes.
Alba was on the phone with another government worker. So please, I want to play, and let's not laugh this time because that is not a funny sentence at all to open with.
Hello, good evening, welcome, hello. How about one more time for the filthy little fucking chief that was just fucking race traitor. You know
what? I started laughing before you even said it. That's not fair.
So when we replayed it, obviously I was going to laugh again. But then halfway through, I said, you know what? I'm going to try not to laugh. And I quit. It made it worse. Funny fucking sentence.
Filthy little fucking leading up to it is hilarious.
Now, but obviously we're laughing because it's so ridiculous.
That's why he said it.
No one would walk up there and say that in a serious setting. It's a comedy club. The reason he said it is because it's an absurd thing to say.
Shane Gillis.
Imagine, could you? Yes, I would have an enormous problem if Tony Hinchcliffe walked into a restaurant and the customer in front of him in line was an Asian American. And then when Tony got up to the register, that's what he said. That would be abhorrent.
That would be pretty bad, yes.
That would be disgusting. Yes. Then he should be dragged through the streets by dogs. Get rid of him. But this is not at a rally. It's at a comedy club, for Christ's sake.
I don't like Tony Hinchcliffe or his comedy, really, but this is by far not the funniest thing he's ever said, right? So we're
Certainly not. And that's the thing. I'm not a Tony Hinchcliffe fan either. You know, I'm not. Like, if you're like, oh, because there's the people will immediately go after you on Twitter and say, just because you're a fucking fan of the guy, you have to defend everything he does. I'm not a fan of his. I didn't particularly like his comedy. I don't listen to his podcast, really. I've listened a couple times. It's not bad.
Well, no one's listening to it anymore.
You're not allowed. Yeah.
No, it got canceled.
How?
I think whatever I was, that's why.
And you just won't have him?
Yeah, whoever was representing him just bailed on him today.
Well, his agents dropped him. I know that.
And I think there was something to do with whoever helped.
They own the podcast or
something like that, because it was going off.
Wow. See, because even I thought there's no way they can cancel that. I thought he was, in a way, uncancelable, because all he does is he doesn't work for Comedy Central anymore. He just does stand-up in his podcast.
I think it was a fighter.
Are you sure about that?
I think it was a fighter in the kid situation. That's what I was seeing. That's why I wasn't sure.
Look that up, because originally I had heard, well, they can't take his podcast away from him.
Because, speaking of canceled, Kumia will be on Rogan tomorrow from my Twitter feed right now.
Yeah, I mean, they got to give it to Rogan. In some ways, he's sold out, but he'll still have a guy like Anthony on.
Kill Tony.
Which Rogan, so I don't know what's going on with this either. Well, you look that up. I'll explain this situation. Have you heard this? Last night and tonight, as we record this, Tony Hinchcliffe and Rogan were doing shows in Texas at the new Creek in the Cave. Well, that changed. Tony was taken off the poster and it just became a Joe Rogan show.
Of course.
Now, it's very possible, and I think actually likely, and I've not seen an update on this, but I think the most likely scenario is that Tony said, I'm taking a couple weeks off while this fucking dies down.
Maybe it is just a couple of the shows got canceled, not the show canceled as a whole.
See, that's what I thought, because Kill Tony does live shows. So at whatever their next dates were, they might have canceled it right after that.
The filthy little fucking chief that was just up here.
No, that is What? I'm sure Tony has said much worse in his home the last couple days.
No, but dude, Shane Gillis felt today like Steve did yesterday.
A weight had been lifted.
Just, oh.
If you search racist comic, it's no longer Shane Gillis.
Let's actually see if that updated. Racist comic.
It's got to be tough. So let's, while you're doing that, play the rest of the clip. Because that's not, I will say there's one part where I'm like, ugh. And I don't think you should be fucking dragged for it. But I was like, he starts to do the voice and I found it a little hack. And it's not, again, I don't find it offensive, but I wouldn't. I'm a white guy, I guess. So I understand that. But I just think like it's been done 10 million times.
Can you hear
me? Unless you do a really good, unique one. Like, I forget who I'm thinking of, but I think it might be like Dan Soder or someone like that.
Yeah.
Or it's like, oh, okay, that's not the same exact accent that you hear every fucking time. It's a slightly different spin on it, and he's actually funny. Where Tony's just being like, you know, the same fucking joke you've heard since the 40s, for Christ's sake. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So let's play that part of it.
Can you hear me right now?
I certainly can, unfortunately.
Okay, because well, as long as I'm recording and I can hear you, everything on my computer is frozen. Anyways.
I can't help but think someone that would have a chance to replace Steve wouldn't do that.
And lose any of the audio.
Well, we'll see about that.
People wouldn't even know.
I'll get a panic text later. We have to redo it.
this is going to be stitches all over this thing now, though.
Why all over?
I'm gonna have to piece so many things together to get the video right after this.
Oh, really? It should just be that one part. Nope.
There'll be like two different videos and two different audio files. It'll be fine.
Oh, all right. Well, anyways, luckily we froze at a good spot. Let's play the rest of that Tony Hinchcliffe video.
Yeah, where were we?
I mean, let's get down to some serious business here. Peng, take it away.
One more time for the filthy little fucking chink that was just
up.
All you fucking race traitors are pooping and hollering.
Okay, again.
Back
there, watching. Right there. So,
who thought he was serious?
I mean, how could you possibly? So that's what I want to know, is the debate that he just shouldn't say those words, even joking. Like, we all know he's joking, but we say he shouldn't be allowed to say that still?
I guess so.
Because no one could possibly think that was serious, right?
No.
Race traitors?
That right there is, you know, the giveaway.
Listen, I know there are people like that, but they don't go into comedy clubs and ruin their careers. Like, if Tony was serious, that would, of course, ruin his career. And even joking, it may have ruined his career. Who knows? But, I mean, it's just so absurd to think that was serious.
Yeah, I'm just curious what else he goes on stage with. If he was just like, I know it'll get him going.
So that's my real issue is with this Peng Deng character, because in my personal opinion, it is so much shittier to film someone else's set, release it without their permission, and post it to social media to show everyone how brave you are, instead of just talking to the guy.
Mm.
He says he never talked to him. I guess, so in, here's the real fucking kicker. In Peng Deng's bio before this, in multiple different social media bios, it says Tony Hinchcliffe's opener, or opened for Tony Hinchcliffe. That's a credit that he advertises in his bio.
Oh, so maybe his post was like, isn't this funny?
Nope. Are you going to say it was a joke?
Wasn't. He was dead serious.
So he did an interview.
Of course he did.
Saying, and he told this place, wherever he did this interview, I'm not sure what outlet it was, but he told them that he was so hurt by Tony's words that he had to go outside and collect himself. Which, listen, I'm certainly not above taking shit too hard or harder than I should. I've done it many times. But I think that's on you. You know what I mean? Like we talked about with Steve. Steve's felt too much pressure or whatever it was, and he put it upon himself to say, I have to get myself right. I did the same thing. Kirk's done the same thing. It's like, you can't fucking blame other people because you couldn't handle something, especially when the guy's a fellow comic that you could have easily walked up to after and A, fucking clocked him if you wanted to. Tony Hinchcliffe is not a big man by any means.
Right.
or just said, hey man, what the fuck was that? Like, that wasn't funny. Like, I was bringing you up and you come on. And then Tony probably would have explained, dude, I was kidding around. I don't have a personal problem with you.
No shit. He shouldn't fucking. All right. Hey, I don't like Asian people and you disgust me. You want to come on the road with me?
Clip that, please. Someone. Thank you. That'll help the tweets. At Craig VGS.
This isn't fair. What am I? What are you? My Bert Kreischer? My fuck dogs?
No, no, no. Once, you know, once you put it on social media, also mention he's a good guy. Mention he's a father, you know? Come
great, on. Great guy, though.
Hell of a guy. Hell of a dad. Hell of a husband. I have another issue. Let's see if you can guess my last issue with the way this clip is done. I suspect you might be able to.
Should we starting it over again?
You know, let's just start it from where it was.
All right. It was already there.
How about one more time for the filthy little fucking chink that was just up here? All you fucking race traders are pooping and hollering. I'm back there watching you puking in a fucking bucket. Oh, we may get a gunpowder.
Okay, so right here. This is not what I was referring to, actually. But I don't find this funny. Like, so to everyone that was like, it just wasn't funny. First of all, I don't have a problem with unfunny jokes, as you, if you know anything about me. I am pro unfunny humor. But also, we have no idea what that's in reference to.
No.
Because to me, it makes no sense. I don't know what he means. I don't know if that's a stereotype I'm unaware of. But what it sounds like to me is that he's referencing something that Peng Deng said on stage prior to him coming up.
Right.
So there's a context to it. That might surprise a lot of people. But there's actually a context where if you were in the room, maybe it made sense. And also you hear that noise that's probably unfamiliar to the likes of Peng Deng. People are making that with their mouths, and it's laughter, merriment, joy. So the people in the room, the audience, seems to be enjoying it. Now, maybe they're all racists.
Yes.
Maybe everyone there is a racist. I don't know. I don't know them. I have not met them. Maybe an entire group of racists politely sat through an Asian comic opening for Tony Hinchcliffe. It's very possible. I don't know. So I don't find the accent funny. I think it's actually a little hack, which surprises me because I don't think of Tony Hinchcliffe as a hack. But also it's off the cuff. So maybe in his head it sounded funnier and he would have gone back and listened and been like, oh shit. Maybe you would have been embarrassed.
It's
we don't have the luxury of knowing that.
We should do like a 10-minute just short video comparing this to Shane Gillis's and see and just show you how nothing Shane Gillis's was.
You know what? We should do that.
We should.
Maybe right after this, we'll record that. Defend my guy Shane Gillis. You know.
Well, it's compared to this, it's nothing. He really lays.
I mean, yeah.
He really.
It's so mild. But I don't even want to compare the two because Tony shouldn't be in trouble for this either.
No.
He won't be. However, yeah, I get that the accent probably offends a lot of people. And I didn't think it was funny. Now, I don't have the context of it, but it did. That part didn't make me laugh. The opening made me laugh, which is shameful. You might say very dishonorable, but it did make me laugh, you know, which I'll have to take that to my grave. And my maker will judge me for it someday. But the second part didn't make me laugh. However, I didn't need to feel the need to go after him with pitchforks and torches. But there's one final part that bothers me about that.
Visionless Dave said, Bobby Lee talked about how much extra work he's getting during all this Stop Asian Hate era. And Peng Deng is definitely just victimizing himself to get his name out there for more work. Scummy move.
Yeah. Well, the difference is Bobby Lee is a funny comedian.
Yes, he is.
I don't know the work of Peng Deng, but based on this, I suspect he's a little crybaby bitch that doesn't understand comedy.
Oh, dang. I bet that's his tagline and half his shit.
Let's refrain from making fun of the name, because God only knows what can of worms that'll unearth. It's a very normal name, and it doesn't sound like an offensive stereotype at all. So let's move on from
it. We should definitely. That's why you don't see kids with names that rhyme with each other. Just doesn't.
Well, that's a good point. Yeah, I mean, I don't know if I told this before. My mom used to work with a bigger gal, as she described her, a bigger lady named Polly, who got engaged to a man who, I mean, this seems like sitcomish, but his last name was Wally. Polly so that Wally. Woman became Polly Wally. Now, I'm not fat shaming women. Imagine me, put it that way. But imagine my name is Polly Wally and you see me waddling down the street. That's all she needed. Is someone, Stewie Griffin, following over the tuba.
That is funny.
So let's finish the clip here because there's one more part that really irked me.
I do enjoy that in parentheses it says fake Asian accent. I thought I was pretty real.
Oh, that wasn't Peng Deng talking? That was Tony Hinchcliffe?
Yeah. Can you believe it? They didn't. They already had cross paths on stage, yes.
We make it a gunpowder. Oh, you want extra soy sauce? Oh, you borrow money from us? And you guys are speeding it up, you fucking pussy.
Oh, wait, what happened, Craig? Did you stop the clip?
Nope, that was the whole clip.
No. Certainly that's not the whole clip because it ends in the middle of his sentence, in the middle of a word.
Oh.
So certainly, Craig, you paused it. So please keep playing. Oh,
I get what you're saying.
I mean, what kind of a fucking asshole is this Peng Deng? Obviously, my assumption is that right after that,
he explains himself.
Tony says, I'm fucking around, or wouldn't that be crazy if that's how I did this whole show, or references that he's not a bad guy, or talks about Asian hate, or something that gives that a little context. I think there's a very specific reason that cuts off in the middle of a sentence like that.
The next sentence was, hi, I'm Shane Gillis. Well, thank you. thank you, Austin.
That's my Shane Gillis impression, folks. So that, I mean, Peng Deng, no offense, Peng, but Peng Deng is the bad guy in all of this.
Yeah, he's a dickhead.
He's the villain.
He looks like Asian Tom Myers.
Well, that's high praise. You better hope he's that funny. Because comics are going to be gunning for him now. Shout out to Louis J. Gomez and Tim Dillon. Friend of the show, Louis J. Gomez. They instantly have everyone's back. Like, they just don't give a fuck.
Yeah. I mean,
because those are two guys who genuinely don't have, like, I don't know about Tim Dillon, because I know he has like 15 minutes on Netflix and he had something on Comedy Central. But Lewis seems to have no intention of ever getting a network deal or anything.
No.
So he's just like, fuck it.
No.
He knows his brand, which I appreciate because a lot, you know, it's amazing the amount of people that disappoint you in comedy. Where you thought they were real because they talk about, you know, they talk about cancel culture and how fucking... You know, they'll stick it to the man. They own their own podcast, so why do they give a fuck? And then, you know, when the money comes calling, it's a different tune.
Yeah, it's just blowing my mind that anyone was like, wow, I can't believe he is like that against Asians. It's just...
That's not possible. Like, I refuse to believe people think that.
Hold on. Review the tape.
How about one more time for the filthy little fucking chief that was just up here?
I guess it's not that outrageous that someone would think that. But I'll tell you, I think the people that think that don't have the context of being like, this is a comic. You know, they were presented with it as like, here's a guy talking. You know what I mean? Like, Peng Deng put it out there like, this is how he brought me up on stage. That's not what happened.
Tony Hinchcliffe, who likely had blood-soaked chopsticks in his pocket, came up and then said,
"The filthy little fucking chink that was just
up here. This will be pulled off YouTube. I mean, off iTunes, I guess.
Nah.
Oh, fuck.
What?
I texted Craig the other day and say, hey, let's start putting the free episodes out on YouTube.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, this one ain't going up there. They'll never make it.
Would they say something?
I don't know. I don't know if they would. They have very strange rules about that type of shit.
Let's let Peng Deng file a copyright claim.
Whoa, dare you, Peng Deng.
Holy shit, that was hard to say. Peng Deng file copyright claim.
It's a very normal name.
No, I wasn't saying it wasn't. It's just,
which in their culture probably is a very normal name.
Yeah.
And not silly.
It's John Smith of... wherever.
But yeah, I don't know. If you don't find Tony Hinchcliffe funny, that's fine. If you didn't...
I do not.
If you did not giggle at the beginning of that clip, And again, the half of it I do think is kind of hack and not funny. But it all comes from the same place.
It also really depends on what he says after it cuts off.
Oh, I mean, that's incredibly crucial. What if he just berates someone that would actually talk like that in public right after that? Mm. Maybe he doesn't. I don't know. But we'll never know, you know?
I do enjoy this comment on the video.
What is it?
It says, what a hack. He stole Dat fans material.
Yeah. I mean, really, though, like Dat fan would do that.
Yes, he would.
That's exactly what he did and got destroyed for by Patrice and Voss is just doing that hacky accent.
It was so great. That was one of my favorite Tough Crowd moments.
Yeah. So that's the crime that Tony Hinchcliffe committed is maybe for a second not being funny. But also, he didn't put that on Netflix. Actually, he didn't put it anywhere, now that I think of it. He didn't put that on YouTube or Instagram and say, hey, here it is, folks. Judge my comedy. He was working something out. Evidently, the guy talked about something, which we'll never see that either, what Peng Deng was talking about right before Tony came on stage. No idea what that is that Tony's referring to.
Mm.
But he said something that sparked Tony's interest, and he commented on it and made a fucking joke about it. And he obviously is commenting on Asian hate that is happening in the country. Because that's been such a storyline in the news, that would be an absurd way to walk on stage.
That'd be great, though, if he followed that up with, that's what downtown New York sounds like lately. Like, that was his whole bit.
Just a complete 180 that proves he's not a racist. Yeah. But Peng Deng is like, no, I'm going to put this out there. So I think that's real shitty. I think this, you know, and it's indicative of our generation that, that our instinct is to run and tattle to mommy and daddy that brother was being mean to us. I didn't like what he was saying about me. So let's show the world and make everyone. And now that's on him forever. You know, maybe he won't necessarily lose a job. He loses a couple of gigs, but that's always, we'll never know the gigs that he was never offered because of this. You know, his agency dropped him. He had a couple dates canceled.
Yeah.
And so it's fucking up his life somehow. And why do we have this thing, which kind of, you know, I jotted down here that Brian Callen is back on The Fighter and the Kid now. Did you see that?
I that's been going back and forth and I just gave up giving a fuck.
I get it's official now, I guess.
Good.
One of the guys quit. One of the kids left. Or was fired or something. And Brian Callen is back on that podcast. Now, I never listened to that show. No. So I don't give a fuck. But it is very interesting to me that even if people aren't necessarily guilty of something, or we can't prove their guilt, or we don't even understand the context of what they were saying, we still make them sit in time out for a period of time.
The comments, by the way, are begging for the whole clip.
Oh, all right. Well, Craig, I guess we don't have any choice. I guess we've got to play it for the people again. Let's play it so you get some sort of context.
I'm so sorry. I meant the comments under the YouTube clip.
Oh, I think you meant our people.
No. But
how about one more time for the filthy little fucking chink that was just up here? All you fucking race traders are hooping and hollering.
All right, we don't really need
to play. I'm back there watching you puking in a fucking bucket.
Here's awful accent again.
Oh, we make it a gunpowder. Oh, you want
you're not listening to me?
Socks.
I can hear you.
Oh, you borrowed money from
us. Pause it, goddammit.
I can hear you.
That should be the podcast now. I've just got Tony Hinchcliffe doing an Asian accent in the background. What is that?
It's the floor music there.
But good. I'm glad people are saying that because it shows maybe not everyone's a fucking psychopath, but.
Did you see, by the way, speaking of Hinchcliffe and Rogan and stuff, did you see that Prince Harry is going after Joe Rogan now?
Very timely, by the way, Prince Harry.
Yeah, I was going to say, how do you
news via fucking Telegraph? What's going on?
Literally what I was thinking. How the fuck?
Carrier pigeons let Prince Harry know that Rogan said something about the vaccine.
He's like, wait a minute.
I'll get this to you in a fortnight, America.
Just so you know, my wife disagrees, so I disagree. Rabble.
Yeah, very brave of him to wait till the heat dies down and say, you know, I didn't care for that. Well, by the way, where's Prince Harry's comment on Prince Andrew?
I saw the
New York... talked about that at all?
Say again?
Has he talked about that at all?
Rogan?
No. Prince Harry. Has he talked about his cousin going to fucking pedophile island and diddling kids?
No.
That's weird. Maybe that's delayed too.
I thought you were asking about that. I'm like, I just read it. I didn't see any sound.
Maybe Prince Harry's news on Prince Andrew is coming over via ship.
I guess
it takes a while.
I guess it happened on Dax Shepard Armchair, whatever the fuck show that is.
What, so Dak asked him about it?
Yeah. No. He made the comments about Joe Rogan on it.
I understand that. I'm saying Dax Shepard asked him about that?
Yeah.
Bizarre question to ask Prince Harry.
Hey, what do you think of Joe Rogan?
Hey, there's a kid toucher in your family. Your thoughts?
Oh, you're from incest lineage. Can you tell me what I should think about, you know, staying clean and healthy and vaccinated?
Apparently, they don't like your wife because she's African-American. Any comment?
What do you have to say about that?
I mean, Jesus Christ, Harry. You have your own bag of problems.
Your brother went full Costanza by the age of 20. Can you talk about that, please?
Not to mention, I mean, problems aside for Prince Andrew, the guy doesn't sweat. That's his own, you know, that's an issue right there.
Mm.
That's a man who isn't built for human life.
Visionless Dave wants Dax Shepard's head on a stake.
You're damn right, Dave. Let's crucify this bastard.
I'm all for it.
No, I don't know. I don't even know what Dax Shepard did wrong. I think he just asked him a question.
He's just very annoying.
Is he?
He's super fucking annoying.
A lot of people listen to that podcast.
He has like four armchair whatevers in the top 50 on podcasts. He has like,
I'm sorry. What are armchair whatevers? What does
like
that mean?
One of his podcasts is like Armchair Expert. There's another one that's called Armchair Something Else.
Oh, he has spinoffs?
Yeah. I saw at least two.
What are the... Why?
Exactly. We should start.
Why not just do it on one RSS feed?
We should just start getting that steak together. Go find them.
Well, now, you know what, Visionless Dave? You convinced me. I'm in. Fuck this guy.
Let's do it.
We're going to war with Dax Shepard. That's it. He's the enemy here. It's not Peng Deng. It's not Tony Hinchcliffe. It's not Prince Harry. We're going after Dax Shepard. That fucking Without a Paddle movie stunk, and I've had enough of him.
He milks his sobriety for clout, even though he relapsed. I hate his face.
Well, but didn't he admit that he was lying about that? I give him credit for that. I don't know enough about the story. Maybe Visionless Dave listens a lot more.
I'm all in.
I was
under
the impression
face.
He admitted that he was lying to everyone for however long.
About being sober?
Oh, yeah. Like he said, he was sober for a number of years, and while he was doing that, he was back on... I don't know his drug of choice, but
yeah, he's just becoming one of the leaders of the, you know, we're better than you crowd. And I just,
oh, is he?
Oh,
see,
yeah.
I don't know anything about him.
Good for you. Don't
it's
find
funny.
Him.
It's funny to me that like C-list actors just like, all right, I'll do a podcast. Like, good for them. I mean, for figuring it out. But it is funny that guys like you kind of know from movies. They're like, well, fuck acting. I'm just start a podcast.
So where did this guy get his name from and all his clout? He pulled pranks on people with Ashton Kutcher, and that's where he started.
I forgot that was him.
Yeah. He started on Punk'd. That's where he got his big start.
Yeah, he was in a few Will Arnett movies. you remember the infamous hit, Let's Go to Prison?
I'm trying to find out or remember if there's a movie I enjoyed him in.
Well, I'm sure you liked the fucking Dane Cook movie he was in.
I did. I did like
that
movie.
Of course you did.
Employee
of the month.
Hilarious movie.
Yeah. I feel like there have got to be just like a list of titles in movie studios where they're like, well, we haven't used this one yet.
Yeah.
What can we make Employee of the Month about?
I actually did not actually. I really didn't mind that movie. I thought it was pretty funny.
I'm sure you didn't.
This is
Good Luck Chuck. All Dane Cook's hits.
So that was fun. There was another one that I didn't enjoy. I forget what it was. The one after Good Luck Chuck, possibly. It was kind
of. Cook must like fucking have a Kevin Hart voodoo doll. Like Dane Cook was on top of the world, and now that's just Kevin Hart's career. Dude, everything Dane Cook could have had, his brother fucking stole from him.
His brother stole from him, and all his fellow comics basically took him down.
Yeah. Everyone was like, hey, this guy is way too fucking successful, which I'll grant you. But they didn't do that to Schumer. Schumer got too successful too quickly.
She was a woman.
Well, yeah, they were afraid.
And Dane Cook was ahead of his time, I think.
Well, I don't know about that.
Fame-wise.
I think he might have been after his time. He was perfect for like the 90s.
Yeah.
Dane Cook would have fucking crushed in the 90s.
Also, the Step Brothers Dane Cook pay-per-view 20 minutes.
That might have done it. That might have been his final nail in the coffin.
It could have been. That was.
Where after that, you kind of just thought of him as a douchebag.
Right. Not a good look.
Yeah. Now, do we have any idea how long we've done?
Roughly 50 minutes, maybe.
Okay. Try what we can go over an hour. I'm going to be gone all week. Oh, that's what I haven't talked about. I got to go to a fucking bachelor party this weekend.
Yeah, it'd be fine. Well, this is going to be good.
For a guy that's already married.
That's weird. He's
been married for like 2 years.
He never got to do his bachelor party?
Right. He had a very small wedding. I got to say, I admire his wedding. I didn't even go. I wasn't invited to that. I was invited to this. But he had, it was like, you know, 15 people maybe.
Huh.
Like a few friends and his family at just like a beach or something like that.
Yeah, Mike.
Quick ceremony and then a party.
I don't want you talking about my wedding on any of your shows, so you can sit this one out.
No. I didn't have any ears in front of me at that time, so. But that's the way to do it, I would think, as far as weddings go.
Yeah.
Have 20 people you like there. Get a few kegs.
Mine was 95 people. And it was originally before the pandemic and some other like family shit that happened. Supposed to be about 250, just under.
Mm-hmm.
Because my family's huge. So I lucked out not having to plan a wedding that size.
Yeah. How many people were at your bachelor party?
9, including myself.
So I feel like shit the last couple days. Like I feel I got allergies in fucking, if I released the original moron money that I filmed yesterday, you would have seen me coughing up a fucking hairball. I was like a sick cat. Oh,
bachelor party in wherever you're going. Almost
that. Yeah, and that's the other thing I don't want to drink. There's nothing more I hate than adult peer pressure.
Yeah.
You know, it's like I'm almost 30 years old. Do you really have to call me gay if I don't want to drink at noon?
Yes. It's so much fun to do that. Have you listened to Very Good Show? That's half of it.
That's fair. Yeah. But that's not my, it's not my bag, man.
It's the funnest thing to call people. It's a real shame we can't anymore.
That is true. You know, they've taken, but we ask for so little now. They can't give us that one back.
Just give it back.
All right, fucking ruin Tony Hinchcliffe's life. We're all right with that.
I will sacrifice the fuck out of Tony Hinchcliffe to call people F words again. It's so much fun.
Well, hey, Jesus. We said gay, not.
I said fun.
Yes. Are you vaccinated?
No.
I'm not going to be allowed outside.
I went to my, by Pat and Lauren says, Mike, you pressured us into this Patreon.
I certainly didn't. I actually did the opposite. I said, please don't subscribe if you don't want to.
The complete opposite.
Yeah. I said, for the love of God, if you don't want to be here, and I stand by that, Pat, if you want to unsubscribe, by all means, please. I don't want anyone here that doesn't want to be here. I appreciate it. I appreciate the support, but, you know, if you miss the $5 or $10 that's going out of your bank account every month, then please don't do it. Put it in Bitcoin, I would say.
He did throw a winky.
Oh, am I sick of that asshole, too, by the way? What were you going to say? I'm sorry.
He threw, Musk.
Yeah. What were you going to say?
I said he did throw a winky face in there, but I left that part out.
You know, we talk about context. And you're the most egregious offender.
I know, right?
I berated Pat from Lawrence all because you manipulated his words. Pat, I'm sorry.
Well,
did you accept my apology?
To be fair, I did throw the message up. You can't read it.
Oh, all right. Well, that doesn't help me. But
yeah, sure doesn't.
Yeah, fucking. well, I'll get to Elon Musk in a second, but I was in. I'm very excited for this. My own discrimination to come. Because I was in. I mentioned it on the Kirk Minahan show the other day, but I was in an Uber the other day, and first thing the Uber driver asks me when I get in the car, because I have my, I generally, even when I'm like, I don't need it if I'm just leaving my house, it's familiar territory, but I generally have the cane out if I'm getting an Uber, because it shows them like, don't be an asshole and park down the street or across the street. Come, please come get me. So I have the cane out, and I get in the car, and first thing he asks me is, do you mind if I ask you a personal question? I say, all right. He's like, how big is your dick? No. And he says,
can it fit my mouth?
How blind are you?
Jesus.
He's like, so I do the whole spiel that I always do. Like, well, I can see people. Like, if you were coming down the street at me, I would know you were coming at me. I would probably know a guy was coming at me, but I wouldn't necessarily know it was you, you know? And he goes, oh, okay. So he starts telling me about all the blind people he's met in his life. I'm like, yeah, actually, as a matter of fact, I don't know them. It might surprise you. But it's like when you add, like, if you go to fucking UMass Amherst, your aunt says, like, oh, do you know so-and-so? It's like, oh, man, there's actually 20,000 people. So, no, I haven't run into your friend from work's grandson.
Shit like that is weird, though. Shit can happen. My sister went to UMass Amherst, and she later, like 5-6 years after being there, met her soon to be husband. Turns out they had the exact same house for rent. So it is a small world. You could possibly find them.
What do you mean had the same house?
They rented the same house by happenstance when they were staying at UMass Amherst.
Oh, just in different years?
Yeah.
Well, I'll be damned. Yeah, world.
See what I mean?
That's pretty crazy. Go, you know, cut that out of this podcast and do a whole episode about it on a very good show. I don't want to steal that from you. That's the kind of guy I am. I give you that story back.
You know what? Send that over to Kirk. Let him see what I got.
An audition tape.
Let him see what I got.
You know, I know you poo-pooed the idea, but slide him a CD.
He did then say anyone in Blind Mike's orbit, which means Matt Morrell. throw that resume at him. Throw that resume at him.
He doesn't deserve it. He doesn't deserve your stink on him. So yeah, he quizzes me on being blind, which are all very original questions that I haven't heard 10 million times. By the way, I mean, I know I've said this before, but as a quick aside, if I say the word see or I saw this on Twitter, you don't have to immediately respond. Did you? We got it. I mean, I've heard it. It's, you know, the 10,000 times. It was funny for a while. And then it's like, I understand.
Oh, yeah?
You saw it?
I know the answer to this.
Or like, the people that DM me and like, hey, you probably won't be able to see this. So, well, then why are you sending it to me?
Visionless Dave's asking, Mike, do people ask if your hearing is extra good since you are blind?
No, that's actually a very original question. No one's ever thought of that. Thank you, Dave. That's funny. Superhero. I have my fucking standard answers for all of these. Oh, actually. I'm such a hack because I bitch about it, but then if you saw me answering that question, oh, well, as a matter of fact.
Mike sounds like Peng Deng whining about blind jokes.
No, the opposite. I'm talking to you people. I'm coming to you and saying I've heard enough.
It's like I come on stage and be like, where'd everybody go? Huh?
It'd be great if I just started. I'm like, look at what this piece of shit said.
Start using the mic
tagging
stand. Using the mic stand as a stick, trying to feel my way around.
Tagging
the
Mass Commission of the Blind on Twitter. Look at what they did to me. It's a gif of me getting in the face with a wallet.
Another question, but really though, is your hearing improved?
It's not. All right, I'll give my standard answer now. It's that we focus more on our hearing. All right, we don't have supersonic hearing. It's just that we focus more on our hearing, so it is better. You pick up more.
Does that answer your question?
So after the after the guy was done, you know, interrogating me. Oh, well, do you, are you able to drive? No, no, as a matter of fact. And then he goes, you vaccinated? He was like, how about you ask me how often I have sex with my wife, huh? I mean, Jesus Christ, pal. We just met. A little small talk first.
You ever get weird and, you know, get stretched, huh? You ever done that?
Yeah, what do you jerk off to? I'd much rather have that conversation than the 10 millionth vaccination conversation.
We'll get you to drive in Madawaska.
Oh, thank you. I appreciate that.
Gotta get that video that Portnoy never made.
It'll be a lot of fun. So he goes, are you vaccinated? And I go, I don't know why. I said, no, I'm not. And he goes, what?
Get the fuck out of here.
And you see this? It says not welcome.
See, you hit the fucking sidewalk, then your cane hits you in the eye.
And take this with you.
He comes around, just snaps your glasses and hands them back.
And stay out.
You won't be needing these.
He was very outraged. And, of course, like a pussy, I was like, oh, we'll probably get it soon. It's like, is that going to be every conversation we have with people now? Like, it's not an interesting thing. I get that it, you know, breaks whatever awkward ice there is in a conversation.
Can we go back?
But it's not an interesting subject.
Go back to the weather. It's an easy one that everyone can weave in and out of.
Right.
Get the conversation
going. You're not going to jump down my throat for being a fucking racist or some liberal cuck, depending upon my answer.
Yeah, every time I went into a stop today, they're like, oh, the weather's good, huh? And I'm like, yeah, about time. And then I just do my shit and leave.
That's fun.
Standard, get in and out. There was no, like, you vaccinated, you fucking piece of shit.
That does sound nice.
It was pretty good. Gets in and out, gets the awkward, weird, hey, hi, how are you? Out of the way.
Shit. What else did I want to say? Oh, I guess I don't give a fuck about Elon Musk. I'll save it for
more on money. Alien,
which you can find here on patreon.com/blindmike. Thank you, Alex Jones. Is that my
art? That's what you heard, yes.
patreon.com/blindmike. You get 2 more on monies a week. The free one is also on YouTube every Friday. Check that out. And we got to do a bunch of other shit, like make fun of Tom Myers.
Can't wait.
You know?
No Mike.
As if I'm not enough of a hack. Mike. As if I didn't fucking have a breakdown over not being able to handle my life. Let's attack another guy. No, Tom Myers, I think, is a good sport, so go check that out on patreon.com/blindmike. Go check out Very Good Show.
Yes.
At Craig VGS, at Very Good Shows on Twitter, I believe.
Yep, hashtag VGSKMS.
Yeah, please don't. Let's not start a thing. Now I have to answer for you for some reason.
This is your fault. I only did that when I saw you go, I'm not responding.
And then it's either, and then it's
I'm not
either,
responding to him. I'm just going to let him sweat it out. I heard you.
And then I either have to defend you as a nice guy, even though I'm annoyed by it, or I have to throw you under the bus and listen to people. Mike's a piece of shit. Fucking no loyalty with this guy.
Does that happen?
I will. Don't no. You know, you have enough. You have your followers. They'll come after me someday.
I think they're the same fucking people. Just some of them trickle my way and find my Twitter.
Yeah, just people that don't like me that want an excuse. Yeah, we can give them shit for this today, I guess.
It's 6:49, 11 to the hour. Someone's asking in the chat.
Oh, is it 6:49?
Yeah.
Oh, so we've been doing this over an hour. My God. Well, the people, I'm not going to be here for a couple of days, so the people need their content. So we can do a little extra, I guess, but yeah. I don't know how to handle this bachelor party because I don't like being like, I'm not going to drink.
Have you, do you drink?
I really don't want to go.
Are you drinking at all?
Yeah, like I've said, I'll have a few seltzers.
Now, are you going out
maybe
when you're there?
Maybe take a few puffs of weed if I'm doing. No, I don't, I mean, I've been out to dinner.
No, I'm saying that you at the bachelor party, is this like a stay at the house bachelor party?
Oh, I have no idea. I hope that's what it is.
Because then you can go nuts. Who gives a shit?
I guess, but I don't even really want to.
That's true.
It's like that just leads to me fucking tweeting some dumb bullshit and texting people like, I'm sorry. I know you never fucking liked me.
Craig fucking sucks. I can't wait for him to leave me.
I sent it to you.
The cunt won't even look at me.
I know you never fucking liked me, and I'm sorry. I've been working on it. Wait, who is this? That person changed their number 6 years ago.
I'm gonna get a text. Am I a good boss? Tell me. Be honest.
You know, I know you don't need this. I know. I can't afford much. I'm sorry.
No, it's been beneficial. My the very good show had its best week or best opening night for sure.
Best opening night. What does that mean? Oh, like the when you release it.
Yeah. Yeah.
That you guys are on Broadway now or something.
We're on Broadway. And everyone's trashing Mike Harris because he's being a bitch. Yeah.
Catch the matinee. Yeah. Very good show.
Yeah, go check that out.
Yeah, so what's Mike's deal? I have to wait around for him now or what's going on with
that? No, I want to do it without him because, you know, I have kids too. This fucking piece of shit.
I understand.
We're coming.
I mean, we could always do it Monday if you wanted. Then we just kind of get, you know, backlogged. But
well, here's the problem. We're recording on Sundays now. Because my wife's going to school on Monday nights. Here's the problem now, because Mike can't do Sundays, apparently.
So Mike's off. Very good show. I'm curious about this.
It's going back and forth. I just think it would be funny for the days he can't do it, if you could. You'd be fucking mad.
You know, it's fun. I like doing shows with you guys, but I'd honestly prefer to do it with Mike. No offense.
Oh, burn.
I just enjoy when Mike's there. I think it's fun.
I enjoy when he's there too. He's just bugging the fuck out of me lately. Not
Is there a vent about it?
No, just his like I have this show, my show, work, her school, two kids, all this shit. Right. I ask him to do one show a week and he can never seem to make time for it. He's incapable of being flexible.
What a hunk of shit. You know, folks, if you made it this far in the podcast, lay off Craig. He's a good man. Call him Mike. At Mike_VGS. He's the real problem here. He's the real racist.
Go for him. Say he's the real all caps racist homophobe.
You're damn right.
Hopefully
we can get that going.
And he hates guns.
By the way, gearheads, for those of you listening live, let's get this. I'd like the comments to start blowing up. I see some people comment that once in a while.
Yeah.
A few of the gearheads will say, why aren't there more comments? And I agree with that. So start fucking hustling. And if you're, you know, stealing this from me for free, then come on back by the Patreon. That's $1 a month.
Yeah.
But hold on. No, they're right. I am a hypocrite. Holy shit. Don't give me $1 a month if you don't want to.
Hon, I got this, boss. Give him a fucking $1 a month. He's blind, people.
No, come on. No. Come on. They're good people.
Matter of fact, give him 10. Be the first.
Oh, yeah. It's funny.
Be the first silent partner.
This when we came back. While we were recording the first half of the show, like when we got when your computer froze, we received a new $10 patron, which I appreciate. Whoever you are out there, thank you very much. But I like that their first image is just fucking, and then like we cut out.
Let's see. Let's give them a shout out. Who was it?
Well, maybe they don't want their name out there.
Yeah, if it's looking like a real name, yeah, it's a whole full name with a middle initial.
God forbid. They're like, hey, asshole. I gave you $10 a month. I don't want my fucking my family out there now. Now, all of the gearheads are very good people. I appreciate every dollar pledged. But in all seriousness, if it's something that, you know, bothers you at all, even if you can afford it, but you still look at your bill every month and you say, what the fuck am I paying this asshole? $1 a month or $5 a month, whatever it is, then by all means, unsubscribe. I appreciate the support you've given. And any continued support, I very much appreciate. The guys like Visionless Dave and Pat from Lawrence.
Don't be pussies. Chat. Don't be pussies. Go. Don't be pussies. Give us all your money.
Oh, go on. Come on. You're too kind. So yeah, thank you guys for watching, and those of you watching for free, think about subscribing at patreon.com/blindmike. Free More on Money on Fridays. I already said that. I'll be on Kirk Minahan Show all next week, which you guys probably weren't going to listen, but now, you know, I figured I had to promote it. Kidding, of course, but listen to that. Goodbye, Steve. Very sad.
It is.
Very sad, actually.
I listened to it twice because the first time I listened to it, the whole time I was just like, oh my God,
Like, I just couldn't believe he actually
was shocking. I couldn't believe it.
Yeah. I just never thought he was going to leave. I thought he was going to take like a pretty long vacation.
Yeah.
And I did.
Well, hopefully
I did,
he's happy seeing the, you know,
I did enjoy
world's largest apple pie baked.
I did enjoy when Kirk was like, yeah, we're not, you know, discouraging, you know, talent or anything. You're like, wait a minute.
This is about him. We don't discriminate here. Yeah, you'd be untalented. This is stupid.
You're like, this is about him.
Hold on.
But when you were at your peak shocked and you're like, I forget what exactly you said. You're like, wait, are we making fun of me?
Well, because he was saying like shit that I say. He's like, you know, it's too much for me. I think I need a mental break.
Yeah.
He was saying it more eloquently than I did, but I thought that was part of the joke.
I don't know. I was like,
is this, not to be a real selfish asshole here, but is this, am I not getting this?
It was enjoyable. It sucks, but I'm glad for him if that's what he wants.
Yeah. Yeah. Good for him. I had a thought and it escaped me. I'm sure it was a good one. I'm sure it was one of my best. I was about to fire out something where you'd be like, you know what? This guy is talented. Damn, let's make it to Mike. Get a $20 tier. I'm editing my pledge, but we'll never know. It escaped my mind and we'll never know what it was. So, you know what? I'll think of it by next week. So make sure you come back for another edition of the Blind Mike Project. Anything before we go, Craig?
Listen, a very good show. I love you.
Anything else, Tony Hinchcliffe, before we get out of here?
Fuck. Yeah, Tony. Hey, Tony.
Tony, you got anything to say to send us off with?
Hello, good evening, welcome, hello. How about one more time for the filthy little fucking chink that was just...
Oh, no, Tony, that's no way to say he's getting crazy. We better get out of here. Wow. Talk to you next week.
What a beautiful world. I see clouds of gray and clouds of white, the bright blessed day and the dark sacred night.
Fuck you.